Good afternoon. I'm glad that you all could join us today. We're capturing life in Pflugerville over the last 50-plus years since the city is 50 years anniversary. Tell me your name.
Lloyd Hibby.
And where were you born?
Pflugerville, Austin, Texas, Brackenridge here.
Willard Hibby, also Pflugerville, Texas, at home.
What is your role in the city today, our community?
In the community today, I work for Citizens National Bank here in Pflugerville.
And your role?
I'm retired. I'm a member of the Lions Club, so I do a lot of charitable work for the city of Pflugerville, I guess you could say.
What were you doing in 1965?
Well, in 1965 was my senior year in high school, so that was my senior year, so there was a lot of things going on back then. One of the things I guess it would be important nationally at that time was that was the year that we were required to have integration, so that was the first year we had that, and I had two African-American girls in my class, and they both graduated. One of them was Linda Robinson, and her dad was Willie Robinson, and I think there's five children in that family, and they all were graduates of Pflugerville High School, and all of them went on to graduate from the University of Texas. So that took place, and I think that we, everything went smooth because we were all a small community, and we all knew each other, and we played together, prior to that happening. So when we went to school, we were just going to school together. And one other thing I remember about that, I guess, that when I played football, and that year we went to Bi-District, and we went there. The team we played there had won state in their league the year before, and there were some pretty big guys there, and we didn't win the football game, but we had a good game.
And what were you doing in 1965?
I was going to the University of Texas at Austin.
There was something significant that happened in that period of time. You took eggs to Austin, and Charles Whitman happened to be in the tower.
Yes. I think, was it a Saturday, if I remember right? I believe it was a Saturday. No, not a Saturday?
It was a work day.
It was a work day. Anyway, I don't remember the exact day, but I'd gone down, had a class in the morning, and I was on my way home on I-35 when I heard about it. So I missed, I was glad I wasn't down there during that time.
On that day, I was went to work for my future father-in-law, and I was working across from Dessa Hall in a field plowing for him. And when I came out from lunch, heard about that, the shootings.
You heard it on the radio?
Yes.
All right, so when you, did you also play football?
Yes. I was almost, never mind. Yes, I did. I played all 4 years, we started in like, I believe the fifth grade, there was two in our class, and I was very small, but two of our guys got to play on the junior high team that year. And then in the sixth grade, we were able to play on the junior high team, the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. And then, of course, when I started in 9th grade, I was, of course, a member of the 55-game winning streak. And when I was a senior, we lost the very last game. So, yes. In fact, the winning streak started the year before I was a freshman. So during that whole time, only lost one game the last game of the year.
Over
5 years.
5 years.
5 years, I guess.
What position did you play?
Called a wing back on offense, the center or the quarterback, and you had two backs, and the wing back lined up usually right behind the left, the end. And my main job, blocking, of course, to help the end or whatever, but usually, the best player on the defense is the middle linebacker. He's supposed to get all the tackles. The linemen kind of goot their guy in so nobody can get him, so the linebacker can get all the tackles. But a lot of the time it was my job to, especially on sweeps going around one end or the other, it was my job to get the middle linebacker. So that was exciting.
It was usually a big person.
It was usually a big person, so I had to hit him at the knees or below the knees to.
Who was your coach?
Charles Kemple and Hub, H.L. Hub Kemple.
Throughout the whole 5 years?
Throughout the whole 5 years, yes. They started, I think, what, you remember, Lloyd's, three or four years before we were in high school. So they started when we were in probably the fourth or fifth grade.
What were the names of some of the schools you played?
Hutto, Manor, you know. Dripping Springs, Blanco, it depends on it, just like it is now in the UIL. Yeah. You know, they would change the districts, but that would, you know, Johnson, we played Johnson City, we played Kyle.
Buda. Leander.
Granger. Bartlett. Bartlett is who I played that when I was a senior that we played in for the bi-district game. Mm-hmm. One thing I think would be significant as far as when you think about Pflugerville and when you think about the football there, a lot of people don't know, but when we practiced, we had a lot of kids that had bad ankles. And the reason we had bad ankles is because they could not water our field. They watered the field, but where we practiced was not watered. And as you know how it is in summer, there's big cracks there. So with the football, we were stepping in cracks and turning our ankles. So we had, you know, a lot of problems with that because the water supply in Pflugerville was very limited at that time, so you know they were prohibited from, you know, watering the football fields.
So we had to get them taped all the time. They had to put tape on your ankles, both of your ankles, so you wouldn't turn them. That was before the game. You had to get your ankles taped.
Did you have a weight room?
Very few weights.
So no, we did not. Maybe when he was 3 years later than me, but we did not.
We had
our weights were hay bales at home.
Yes, that's true. Okay.
Who were the bus drivers then when you played out-of-town games?
The coaches. Well, we went out of town. Charles Kemple, who was the head coach, he drove the bus all the time. And Hub was capable of doing it. He had a bus route during, you know, the regular school. And that was the thing, like, a lot of people don't realize the coaches back then, they were up at 7 in the morning to drive the bus, go to school, and you know, then do their coaching, and then they'd have to drive the bus in the afternoon. And then if they had, it was especially hard, and I know personal experience talking to Charles Kemple, that at that time he had three small sons, and it was very hard for him to spend any time with them during basketball season, because a lot of times they'd practice after school, or the time he got from his back home from his bus route, that he would have to go directly to the basketball games. And we went home, they were already in bed. So really, I think he had talked to the superintendent at one time that he took some time. He'd go home at lunch and got criticized a little bit for it. And I think he told him that that was the only time he got to see his kids, so he was gonna take a few minutes to go home at lunch.
And we didn't, our PE was the last period of the day. It was like from 2 to 3, so we'd practice that last hour of the day so they could drive the bus. So during that 55-game winning streak, very rarely did we practice after school or, you know, like 2 or 3 hours or something. It's just that 1 hour. If we had a real important game or by district, very few times did we extend it past that 1 hour in the afternoon. Like I said, they had to drive the buses, and a lot of the kids had to get home and do chores, too.
When that took place, our dad was usually the one that would come up and substitute drive for Coach Kemple. That he was farming, so he was able to do that. So he would come up, and that was, he was also on a school board, and that was just him volunteering to do that to help out with things.
That's right.
Okay, another thing that happened in high school is most boys took FFA, and so did you have projects?
Yes. Yes, and most of the thing, and that's, we had hogs and we also had chickens that we did, and a lot of where we lived, also, as part of our projects was in the summer that, or throughout our growing up, we had around 20 sows, which is a mother hogs, and we raised little ones, and that was, we raised those and sold them, and that was where we got the majority of our money to go to college was from working with her dad and helping raise those hogs to generate funds for that.
And And what breed of hog did you have?
Duroc. Had Duroc hogs.
Or the red ones. We actually started in 4-H. FFA was mainly 9th through 12th grade, I believe. So before that, I think 4-H you could start in the, I think we were in the third grade, 9 years old. So we were in 4-H, you know, until FFA in the 9th grade.
Where was the Travis County Stock Show held?
At that time, it was at the, I guess we called it the Coliseum, was it right on the Colorado River, I guess is what they call Auditorium Shores now, but that's where it was held. They also, back then, Austin had a semi-pro, I guess you'd say, baseball team, and that's where you could take your animals out to that, out on that baseball field if you had to walk your hog. If it was a little bit overweight, you wanted to try to walk it a little bit, or the people would go out there and walk their calves, they would use that baseball field for doing some of that. I think they called them the Austin Senators at that time.
Yeah.
Who that was right close to or built the baseball field or owned the Austin Senators?
As far as I know, it was Mr. Knievel from, and he was also instrumental here in Pflugerville and started 7-Up Bottling Company, but he was very generous and, you know, from the 7-Up baseball and then, you know, to help bring baseball to Austin at that time.
When you would sell your animals in the sale, business people would bid on your project, and then that was money that went into your college fund?
Yes. Yes, I remember 1 year, Willard Pfluger, he had a business here in Pflugerville, I think delivering gas to farmers and so forth. He bought one of my capons, but they all, a lot of them pitched in and bought, helped the kids out.
That's the way it was done then. The individuals, or they had some. There was also an individual out here, Mr. Foster, that had a propane company that he bought a lot. One thing I learned from that is after I graduated from high school and started working at the bank and things, and also was doing farmer, my dad and I always donated to the Pflugerville Seal Community Farmers. Everyone in the community did, and then that group would go down to the shows and buy. They've been doing it ever since then, since the early 70s. And also when I went to work for First State Bank in Pflugerville, that I continued, I got to where I could go down and buy animals there. And I have done that throughout my career. And here 2 weeks ago that they had the show in January for the Travis County show, and Citizens National Bank is a participant in that. So I went down and helped the current kids with their projects.
You went to the University of Texas, and what did you graduate? What was your major?
My original major was math, a math degree.
And then what did you do in your career?
And I went to graduate school, and that was at just the beginning of the computer age. They didn't even have compute classes in it at that time. So I graduated in 67, I guess. So I went to graduate school for a couple years, and they had some graduate courses, but in computers, which is related to math very much. So after I did that, I it was not a lot of businesses here in Pflugerville. I mean, in the Austin area at that time, you know, for big companies to hire people. I guess there was IBM, but not many others. So there was a limited opportunity, you know, to work and stay in the community unless you know, the state offices and jobs, I guess, like that. But anyway, I got an interview with Texaco in downtown Houston and went and interviewed and was going to come home. I decided to spend the night. And I went out to NASA the next day, just driving around, and I stopped in at Lockheed. And they had some openings, and of course this was the race to the moon that John F. Kennedy did early in the 60s, and we had wanted to get a man on the moon by the end of the decade, which would be, you know, the end of the 60s. So anyway, this was in April. And so I took the job with Lockheed and went to work at NASA. And I like to say I was there 3 months and we got the man on the moon.
That's good.
So, I didn't have a lot to do with that, but it was very exciting working there. And
you were a programmer?
Yes, I was a programmer, and it's programming is talking to computers, making computers, you know, understand or do what you want them to do, and it's very tedious. And it has changed greatly over the years. Of course, in those days, you had little cards that were about 6 inches by this long, and you had little
key punch,
like a typewriter, but like a key punch, put little holes in it. So you would, if you wrote a program or something to do, you'd have all these little cards, and your program would be maybe 200, 500 cards like this. And we would correct the cards, make the error corrections, and somebody would pick them up and take them over to the computer, and we'd almost have to wait till that afternoon or the next day to get the results of that. So it was a long process to get something right, to correct your errors. You could just any typo, like if you typed a O instead of a zero or L instead of one, the computer did not like that. So it
period instead of a comma, put it in the loop and you'd get a whole stack of paper with nothing on it.
Very frustrating, but very rewarding when you did get it to work. So but
what
yes.
was the feeling of excitement when there was success at Houston, at NASA?
Well, just a lot of excitement. Of course, the astronauts all lived down in that area, and everything was right there. So that was our offices were right offside from NASA, but right there in NASA Bay or Clear Lake City. So we were very close. It was very, very exciting time.
And your career, when you also went to UT?
Yes.
And got a degree in?
Majored in math, and at that time, my minor was in computer sciences. By that, there was, you know, that's how much it had developed from when he was there, that you could get a minor in computer sciences at that time.
And so what was your jobs out after college?
Well, one of the things, I guess when I got out of college, that I had an interview with IBM, and I had an opportunity to go to work for them, but it was in New York State, and I did not want to leave Pflugerville, so I stayed here, and at that time I had a neighbor, his name was Frank Hobbecker, and he was in the construction business, and I went to work for him then right out of college, and one of the things significant, I guess, he was in the road construction, and in, I think it was 1971, getting back to Pflugerville, we had the big fire in Pflugerville. Since he was in the construction business, that he had a big 2,000-gallon water truck, and so I went and got that water truck and hauled water all night long, and we had to go to, Pflugerville did not have the water to support fighting that fire, so we had to go up to, basically up where the Spring Hill Elementary School is, pretty close to where that is located now. There was a fire plug there mm-hmm. from the city of Austin, and that's where we got all our water, and there was a little bit of problem with that later with the city of Austin because all the water we used, but helped fight the fire all night, and with the firemen, and after that night, they were saying, you know, you're up here helping us. I said, you know, you really ought to join the volunteer fire department so you have some insurance in that. So I joined the volunteer fire department at that time and was a member of it, you know, until about 1989. Mm-hmm. And one of the things, I guess, and then after that happened, I worked there a couple of more years, and then I went to work for the First State Bank of Pflugerville. And I worked there and started at the old bank building that's at Railroad in Maine. And Pflugerville was growing, and that bank was too small. We did not have a drive-in facility, so that facility was moved up to First in Maine in 1975. And one thing that was significant there is when we had fires back then, that there was fire phones, and I think we had 10 fire phones, 10 or 12, and they were in the homes of the firemen. So whenever the phone would ring, you were supposed to let it ring three times and then answer it, so all of the different people could answer it. Well, they also had one of those in the phones in Marshall's Tavern and a couple other businesses in town. So when we moved, the bank moved there, we also had one of the phones was put into the bank, and at that time, technology was advancing. They put up a big tower where we had radio communications. So we put another, what they call remote control at the bank. So during the day, whenever there was, the town was small, if we had fires during the day, that Police Chief David Beeson and myself were in town, so we would answer the fire phone, and we were basically the fire, we were the fire department for the daytime. We would go out to a fire, then we could radio back from the fire truck back to the bank, and we had the employees there operated that, and they could then, you know, get on the phone and call TU Electric, or if we had other things that we needed. So, you know, the bank played a, it was a community effort, you know, that everybody helped out each other, but that thought that that was pretty significant what we did at the bank. And then if we, since we had that, then with the fire department, Robert Weiss was the chief at that time, and he was provided with a two-way radio. So if we had something really big that we couldn't handle, we could call him, or even if we, if nobody else was around, we could call him, and he would tell us where he was, and he said, bring the fire truck, I'll meet you at the fire. So that was kind of some things we did in the early days of the fire department.
What were the most common types of calls that you got that you needed to respond to?
A lot of it was, you know, some of it was car wrecks, other mostly was grass fires back in those days. And I remember one significant summer that we were having fires all along 685 one summer. I mean, they were coming, and we thought that we had somebody in the fire department somewhere that was starting the fire just so they could go out and fight the fires. And we finally figured out that there was one of the dairymen around here, the Kruger Dairy. They had land over around Hutto, and they were hauling silage from Hutto to here. And that silage, some of the silage would blow off of their trailers, and then it would cake up on the side of the road when it hit next to the grass, and it would sit there for a day or two, and it would start, that was green, and it would ferment, and it would get hot. And that, it just like years ago, we had hay bales, and we had square hay bales back in those days, and you would put them in the barn, and if you put them in there when the hay was too green, they would get hot and start on fire and burn the barn down. Well, this here was saying that that was what was starting the fires, that was getting hot next to that dry grass in the summertime next to the road. And it would just, because we were out there fighting one of the fires one day, and happened to look over and saw that, and just saw one of them starting to ignite. But that was a lot of that. And then, of course, we had the other, you know, the house fires and everything else, but the majority of it was grass fires back then.
Did you have uniforms?
At first we didn't. It is throughout my time in the fire department. Then we had some shirts so that when we had events that people know who the firemen were. But later on, we did go, and all of us, you know, were trained. You could, you know, where you had air packs and heavier coats and boots and a helmet and things. You know, where we were trained more to go in and fight fires.
The firemen had fundraisers to generate resources to buy equipment. What way did they do that?
Well, one of the main things they did was that we had on Labor Day, they had a big barbecue, and it was for the whole community, and the community knew that that's how we got our funds for the fire department. So we had, I don't know, back then people came from all around. There was probably, you know, 500 to 1,000. I think the firemen probably prepared over 500 pounds of or 1,000 pounds of barbecue, but it was a big turnout. And at the time that was being done was also the time of the year when the farmers were harvesting their cotton. So basically they would have to park the empty trailers after they were ginned off. They would park some of those up around the fire station. So it was just agreement with the farmers. We would take the sideboards off the cotton trailers, sweep them off, and those trailers would, people would stand around the trailers, and that was their table to eat on.
You didn't have a tablecloth, just ate it straight off.
Yeah, that, no problem.
That's probably when the population of Pflugerville was still like 400 or 500, you know, not that big when they were doing all this stuff.
At the time when I was in high school in like 65, Pflugerville, if people are familiar with Pflugerville, that basically if you go to 5th Street and Noten Street, that was Pflugerville. There was nothing else around. Later on, that I don't know exactly what year it was, Emanuel Road, where Emanuel Lutheran Church is, the farm across the road was owned by F.J. Bowles, estate, and they sold that, and Gatlinburg was the first subdivision outside of the town. And then I think Brook Hollow, Gladys and Leon Flugert sold some there. Whenever that subdivision started, that was kind of the end of the day of the cotton gin in here, because if a cotton gin, whenever you gin the cotton, they blow the hulls out into a big stack, and it's creates a very big mass of dust and everything, and that dust would drift over the communities, and they eventually had to shut down the gin just, you know, because of that.
Okay. So, Flugert Hall was built on the fire department area. Do you remember Flugert Hall being built and why it was built?
I remember pretty well, but one thing, when you're talking about where Flugert Hall stands now, I want to back up a little bit, is as far as the volunteer fire department, part of what we did, we were also the sponsor. Well, it started in 1955, so when I grew up and was playing Little League Baseball, the Pflugerville Volunteer Fire Department was who sponsored it. In their Little League, this, if you look at the growth in the communities, at that time, Pflugerville had a Little League team, Round Rock had one, Huddle had one, and Thrall had one. And if you imagine how big Round Rock is now and how big Pflugerville is, we barely had enough to, you know, where we had the four teams, and it was called Syntex, when they'd pick an all-star team from those four teams to go play an all-star team. So that's how small all of these communities were at that time. As they grew, as time went on, when I became a member of the volunteer fire department, that was our job. We sponsored the Little League, so it was our job to go up and maintain the fields and, you know, make sure. J.B. Marshall was very instrumental. He took care of registration, all the rules of the Little League and things like that, and took care of that. But the fire department took care of the fields, and then as we got older, we took care of the fields. Part of what we did for taking care of the fields, we mowed it, did all that. Then a bunch of it, we played softball. And there was a group of firemen and a few other, you know, friends that played. And one summer we played like 130 games one summer of softball. But, you know.
And this was as a young adult.
This was a young adult. This was when we got to be like in our
early
20s. And there were some other people who were older than that. But we didn't lose very many of those games either. So we went and played tournaments. But that was a big part of Pflugerville. And then we would throw tournaments and people would come out and we would raise money there. And, of course, I think we gave that money back to the fire department to help with the upkeep of the field and things. So.
Who were the coaches?
But the field was right where Flugert Hall is today. That's where the baseball field was.
That's where we get it. So one of the things that was kind of when we were going to build the Flugert Hall is that was going to do away with the Little League field. But at that time, there were some other people that got involved with some projects. They built the Little League fields up at Pflugerville Elementary School across from Emmanuel Lutheran Church. But that was a big, you know, it was a big controversy in the fire department at that time if we were going to keep the baseball field so we could support the youth there or let the Pflugert family, you know, build the hall. The Pflugert family saw the need for a community hall and started raising money, and they raised over $100,000 and the majority of the money, you know, to build it. And then throughout the rest of the, after it was built, continued to raise funds to, you know, to pay for it. And when the hall first started, there was a board of five people that oversaw the hall. And out of that, there was three people from the volunteer fire department, which was Robert Weiss, Larry Hoddy, and myself. And then we had two individuals from the Pflugert family. That was my dad, Eugene Hebby, and Julia Mellenbrook. So that was the first few years of the hall being operated. We were the board of the hall, so to speak.
And the volunteer fire department was able to make money by catering some of the events?
That is correct. That's one of the things we had barbecue pits built, and then we would cater the events, and then we would, you know, we tried to also, like, at different times of year, especially New Year's Eve, we used to get a name brand band and have them to come in and would provide a New Year's Eve party, which was very successful for us. Yes.
Mm-hmm. But weddings.
Correct. Go ahead.
Yeah, the hall was for weddings, birthday parties, all kind of parties. You know, there wasn't anything in the Pflugerville area for that. And of course, the Pfluger reunion, which is always held down at the park on July the 4th, 100 degree temperature. So a lot of the people wanted Pfluger Hall built. So anyway.
Reunions were a big part of the community decades ago. Families would gather at least once a year. You want to talk about any of those reunions?
The Weiss reunion. Of course, we had the Pfluger reunion. My dad's mother was a Weiss, so we had the Weiss reunion. He was a Hebby, so we had the Hebby reunion. And my mother was a Pfluger, so we had the Pfluger reunion, the big Pfluger reunion, and actually a couple of reunions there. So that and the church had a picnic, so that was our big summer. We had like five things during the summer after working all day on the farm to come to the reunions. But
so that was the main entertainment.
One thing about the Weiss reunion, they always had mutton, sheep, to eat, which I thought was different. You never had, you know, we were like chicken and meat and potatoes, beef and potatoes, barbecue. But
and they were all homegrown.
They were all homegrown. Yes, they were.
Yeah, I remember that. That was an experience that you would go over on a Saturday and watch them. Or father or whatever, they'd go over and butcher the sheep, and then they would get Marvin Weiss at Seal Store Barbecue to do the barbecue, and that was always the first Sunday in June, and then the Pfluger reunion was always July the 4th, and as we grew up, that was one thing. We went down there, it was like we played baseball all day long, you know, the younger kids.
Fritz's Grove,
yes, down at where Pfluger Park is now, and then
yes.
Yeah, also back then, you know, you would try to get little boats and float them down Gillen Creek, you know, but that was a big event, and you look forward to it to every year.
The original Pfluger Cemetery is on the forks of Wilbarger Creek. Have you been to that cemetery, and tell us a little bit about it?
Yes.
Yes.
Pfluger Cemetery is there, and at one point, the Pfluger Cemetery was getting pretty growed up. It's got a chain link fence around it, but it was getting growed up. And finally, some people gathered a little bit of money and tried to do some things to donate. But I think our dad ended up with the job of taking care of the cemetery, which he didn't ever use any of that money. But and taking care of it in those days, you had poison ivy there, you had vines. So you had to go in there and clean all that up. And this was before the
charging canes.
This was before the time of chemicals, so all of that had to be done by hand. And you know, we got it done with a set a day. He would do a lot of it, and then get other people volunteer. Later years on, you know, you could use some chemicals to try to upkeep it. And over the years, then Willard's son Kevin, I guess you could say, is now has been going down and doing the work to. Upkeep the cemetery.
He's carrying on the tradition, my son Kevin. Yes.
In the cemetery, over the years, there were people who had longevity, lived long time, and then there were many that childbirth was an issue, and then also disease. Do you have any family stories on how things went?
I just remember looking at some of the history book of the Pfluger family, and that was not uncommon. I mean, I'm thinking Henry Pfluger Sr., you know, came over, and he had, 11, 12 children, 13. But he had, like, I counted one time, like 97 grandchildren. I mean, each of the families, you know, they had like 8 or 10 or 12 children also. But you look in the history book, and it was not uncommon out of those 10 children to have two or three, I mean, or one or two, you know, died during the first day or the first week or two of their life. They didn't, you know, it was just, I guess, medical, you know, things that just happened.
Yeah, there's a lot of those, and I don't want, you know, where you see, you look in the history book, and I know I was looking at one family, and I won't, but there was one of those there, they had like, you know, infant child was, their first child was born and passed away the same day. Went back and looked at it, and the second child was like a son. He died when he was 12 years old. Go back in the third one, was married and had a child. She died in childbirth, and her baby died like 3 months later. You know, so I mean, that was just a, I mean, that's a lot of people in one family to, you know, to have tragedy, you know, that, but yeah, there was a lot
of. But these were the early years of settling and.
Yes, probably the late 1800s, I would suspect.
So I guess in those days, I don't know if it's diphtheria, tuberculosis, pneumonia, you know, just different things. I don't know what they, you know, what all the causes of death was, because they didn't have that much.
There was also the Lions Club. Volunteerism was prevalent throughout the community to make things happen.
Yes.
When did the Lions Club start, and what is some of the functions it has?
I was reading last night on our, we have a website now, and it has a little history on there, and maybe Lloyd can help verify this, but it was started in 1975, but it talked about going back to the fire department, all the work the fire department did, and they grew to, you know, a lot of firemen helping there, and besides fighting fires and so forth, they kind of wanted to help the community in other ways, do things besides just fight fires, so, you know, help the community. So I think that's one of the reasons they decided to establish the Lions Club, because it is a service organization. Just serve community. It's mainly for eyesight. It's a national, international organization. But within that broad scope, mainly helping for eyes, that's how it started out, but you also have the ability to just however you want to help your community. And I think that's one reason it got started in 75.
So over the past 40 years, they've had fundraisers to help local people that may need.
Yes, yes. Like I said, the eyeglasses, they do for eyeglasses, so we have a program for the school district, for the real school district, for all the, mainly the first, second, third graders, you know, if any of those are needy, they do tests to see if they need glasses, and we provide money for them to get an eye exam and glasses early in their career as a student. But that, and we also help students or nurses. Now, today, just about every school has a nurse at the school, and we provide money for them for whatever needs they help them, you know, with the needs they have with the students. School supplies, in the beginning of the year, we give a lot of money for just school supplies, whatever that happens to be, pencils, you know, whatever. And we provide scholarships now also to graduating seniors, but anyone in the community, medical needs, you know, real medical need, we help provide them with funds, and we've helped support Little League teams and all kind of, you know, events. A lot of the money stays right here in the community, even though a lot of it goes to the national organization, and we have a Lions camp in Kerrville for disadvantaged kids every summer, so a lot of kids can go there, and it makes a big difference in their lives. There's also riding horses. We support that. There's one over here out at Dessau, and disadvantaged kids, for some reason, riding a horse really changes their attitude and gives them a positive outlook on life, and we've supported that endeavor also quite a bit.
He pretty well covered the other thing that at Thanksgiving and Christmas we also do big donations, and basically what we do is give money and they go to Walmart and places, and we get gift cards, and then the school nurses are really, the school nurses at the elementary school, that they know a lot more about what's going on in those families than anybody else do, because they deal with those kids on a personal basis, and they know the people that to provide for where we give these gift cards where they can go to HEB or wherever to get things for Thanksgiving and for Christmas.
Okay, Lloyd, you knew the Russell family. Tell us about Miss Inez.
Well, I don't know a whole lot. Basically, what she did a lot in the community, as far as she did house cleaning, and she'd go to different homes, you know, and do the house cleaning and ironing, and you know, all of the things like that. And they were, she and her husband Charlie, they were both very active in the St. Mary's church. It's across from the Pflugerville High School. They were very active at that. And also, since I was in banking, I knew them from, they were customers of mine at the bank, so I knew them from there. And I remember when Miss Russell turned 100 years old at the St. Mary's Church. Now has a, you know, large facility there, and my wife and I went to that, and it was really, they really had a really nice celebration. And when you went in there, I was surprised at the, one of the things that they did, everybody was seated. I went, was seated, all the other people were seated, and they had family, her family members, her daughters and all that, they brought plates of food to the table. You didn't go through a serving line like you do a lot of the catering events we have now. They got all the food and brought it to you, and it was, you know, a lot of different kinds of food, and it was all very good, and it was a whole lot more than you needed to have. So it was a very big celebration. Mm-hmm. Her husband, Mr. Russell, Charlie Russell, he used to, before we integrated, I think that he did a lot of work, at the school where they attended. But then after that, he came down, and we had an individual at Pflugerville High School. Mr. Jennings was our janitor, and Mr. Russell helped him, you know, with the school. And then they also did, worked on the maintenance of the buses and things like that. So they were, he was very instrumental in helping with the school district.
We'll talk about the city services, particularly the water department. Mr. Pfluger owned that, and then Herbert Bowles worked for that.
My understanding of it, and I remember when we were growing up, you know, that they had just an old cypress wood water storage tank. And I don't know how many gallons it held. It wasn't that large. But they said the city of Pflugerville wasn't 300 people either. But then they built the big water tower that's, I think it's at, everybody knows where it is, the third and whatever. They had that water tower, and that's what I referred to earlier. That was the only water we had there, so they weren't able to water the football fields and stuff like we had wanted to. And as Otto got older, he had Herbert Bowles to come in, and he helped him, with the waterworks. And they did it for quite a few years, and then eventually, I think that was sold to the city of Pflugerville. From what I understand, they had to go out west of Pflugerville towards IH-35, and they drilled wells there to get more water, for the city of Pflugerville. Like I said, I'm born and raised here in Pflugerville. I live about 5 miles east of Pflugerville. I got married in 1969, and a few years later was going to buy a lot, looking at buying a lot in Pflugerville and moving to Pflugerville. And then a Manville Water, which is between Maynard and Pflugerville, some individuals there, Mr. David Samuelson, I think, and Theodore Timmerman, Leonard Daring, and Glenn Merkson. They got together and they decided they needed to farm water for the rural areas, and so they put in what is Manville Water, is now well known. A lot of the residents of Pflugerville now receive water from Manville, as Pflugerville has grown and into the areas that Manville Water had supplied water. They now get their water from there. But so when we were able to get water from Manville, I was able to build a home out on the farm rather than moving into the town. But it was about the big fire, in the city. There was not enough water there, and I mean we had Oak Hill, I think, had a big water tanker that was something like 10,000 gallons or something. But there, when we had that big fire, the fire back then, that was a big event in Pflugerville, because that was from, if you go where in downtown Pflugerville now, between Railroad Street and Main Street, you know, where the old Dodge City Steakhouse was, that from there west, there was at one time, that's where the Mercantile and Lapine's Hardware and other stores were located there. Well, Prince's Craft had the was located in one of those buildings, and you know, the fire started there, and it burned, you know, the buildings, you know, from the west side, you know, down to there. And there was not enough. One of the reasons that it burned that far was some of it was lack of water. Another thing that they found out when they built those buildings years ago, that they had big wood beams that went through the top of the structures to support from brick wall to brick wall in there, and that the firemen finally figured out that the fire was burning through those big wood trusses up at the top, and that's how it was getting into the next store to burn. And once they figured that out, they were able to stop the fire.
How did they have to cut?
You'd almost have to have diesel mixed with that fertilizer for it to be explosive. You know, but that was a big concern. The fight in the fire was a concern. Was there going to be a problem with the fertilizer that was stored in it?
Tell us about the Kemple Lumber Company. Who was the owner and Rip Kemple?
Rip, his dad, Henry. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Henry Kemple owned it, and Rip was his son, and he worked there. And after his dad passed away, he worked there for many years. It was a lumber company. You know, you got your lumber, your nuts, your bolts, or anything like it, I guess, at Home Depot today. It was a place to go, and a nice place to go and get whatever you needed. And it was sold, when did they sell it? Probably the 80s, I think, sometime in the 80s, I think. But it was a Mutual Lumber Company, so they were, anyway, part of a bigger group, but they owned it, I don't know exactly when they started, but it was an icon. People loved to go in there and just visit and drink coffee and in the mornings, and probably at the bank. You worked at the bank, didn't y'all kind of go over there every once in a while, or they'd come over to the bank or
yeah,
or whatever?
Yeah, that is correct.
One of the oldest companies in town is the German American?
Yes.
Are you familiar with that?
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about that organization.
German American Farm Mutual is an insurance company, and you know, I guess you know, people years ago saw the need for that, for having that, and it's been a very successful at the insure, you know, the barn. You know, they're basically for a rural community, so to speak. They do a lot of things, barns and tractors, and you know, the homes and everything, but they're they've been successful, and you know, they have their annual meeting every year, and they still have three generations people, you know, we're doing business with them, and continue to. They're just a good insurance company.
You were raised on the farm, so let's talk about early farming processes, ways of doing things, and then we'll go to the present. So, what do you remember about farming when you were a young one?
Lot of chopping. They didn't have chemicals to kill the weeds, so during our summers we had to do lots of chopping to get rid of the Johnson grass, the sunflowers, tie vines, whatever was in the field. So that was one thing, but he knows more about it, but we still had horses, a mule, when I was growing up to do it. He bought a tractor in 1950, a C, but to help plant. But he still had a mule to what they call roll, pack the dirt after they planted it. And I remember, and I guess I was in third grade, so I was probably 9 years old. So this was probably in the spring, probably March. I stayed home from school one day to roll the cotton, or the maize, whatever it was. But the story too, the horse or the mules, you know, they were pretty smart. You turned them around at the end and got them on their row, and you could see rows. They would walk right down the row to the other end, you had to turn them around and get them on the right row, and they would walk back. Where if you drive a tractor, you have to continually make sure you're on the right way. But it was small. I mean, we had my dad had there was a government program where you had land laid out every year, and he would plant clover on it, which would help give nitrogen to it, everything. But anyway, when we plowed that, we used it was not like busters where you plow up your cotton or corn or whatever. It was called a one-way. It had three sweeps on it, and it would take about 36 inches, not very much. And we had I think it was the Farmall H.
That's great.
You'd go round and around the field, and you could plow. It took you like a day to do 10 acres or 20 acres. I don't know. You could just go, you just did this much, and it took forever to plow it. And another thing I remember, when I was about in the sixth or seventh grade, we had that Farmall H also. And he wanted me to, I was able to, with the busters on it, with three sweeps, to plow out the stubble. My first time doing it, and I got on it, and it's like, you just, stay on the row. You got three sweeps, and they wouldn't stay on the right row. I couldn't figure out what was wrong. But anyway, my dad had, my uncle was sick, and he had gone to help him help him with his crops, and he had moved the sweeps in because they had different length rows. They were usually 36, 38, 32 inch rows. Different farmers had different.
38 and the other one was 36.
So anyway, yeah. He brought the tractor back, but he didn't move the sweeps back to the right length. So it's like I could, anyway, we figured out what the problem was, but it's like I couldn't figure out why this wasn't working right. But,
okay, so the tractors
Expanding on that, when I was, I rode with my mother, when she had the horse, and basically all you had was four little wheels, these Packers, and then it was a platform made out of two by sixes or two by eights, and you'd put a pillow on there because if you sat it out all day, that two by six was pretty hard. But she couldn't leave me at the house because I was too little, so I had to sit on there with her. So I remember, doing that. The big changes in farming is it took place in the early 60s when it was at a time when we finally started using diesel tractors. And that was in, we got our first diesel tractor in 1962. And one thing significant about it was it had a three-point on the back of it. Well, one of the things that Dad bought when he did that was a post hole digger. One of our projects when we grew up was every Christmas he would build new fences, and we had to dig all those post holes by hand. And when we got that tractor and that post hole digger, we could dig a lot of post holes, and we could build fences, and it was a whole lot easier. But one of the reasons I guess that I started farming with my dad then when I got out of college is that in 1970, that is when they came out with air-conditioned cab tractor. So you go a tractor then was just about like sitting in a pickup. It has the same air-conditioned unit as a Chevrolet pickup, GM. You had that because in the early days, all the things you did was very dusty, itchy. So there was a lot of things that took place there. So going into those tractors, and then those tractors got bigger. And as he was referring to, I know that I've looked at that. I know that I do in about in farming a farm today. I have one area that my dad would farm that it takes me about an hour and a half to plow the field, and he used to go to the field in the morning on his tractor and plow till lunch and walk home and eat lunch and then go back and finish it in the afternoon. So what I do in about an hour and a half, he would pretty be a full day's work for him to do back then, and just a different in your technology that you have now. Another thing that was that changed a lot in our about that time is at that time we grew cotton, and when we grew the cotton, when it got ready to pick, we had some families from Carrizo Springs that would come up and pick the cotton, and my mother would be out in the field, and she would weigh the cotton, and then they would put it on a trailer, and they would take it to the gin to have it ginned. A few years later, They came in, and when they did that, we also had, you know, the families that came up. We provided a place for them to stay and helped them with their food and everything else while they were here. Then a few years later, they came out with technology advance, and they came out with cotton strippers, so we no longer had those individuals to come pick the cotton. They had chemicals that would knock the leaves off the cotton, and then these strippers would go through, pick it, and then mechanically blow the cotton into the trailers, and, you know, we'd take it to the gin. So that was a, you know, a big advancement for that. And that growing cotton around here continued for quite a few years until, as referred to earlier, Pflugerville started to grow. And when they grew, they built the subdivisions around the gin, so they pretty well had to shut the gin down. And then also, when we were growing the cotton, we got to where we would spray the cotton. They had insecticides that you could spray on them, and most of that was done by airplanes. And we had the airplanes that worked good until they got a subdivision next to there, and then the people in the subdivision would, you know, complain about the insecticides and the airplanes. So we discontinued planting cotton and went to just planting corn and milo. And then another significant thing that had that happened in farming was, if you go up to where Stone Hill is now, I remember going up there with some of my neighbors. They had that place, and we went up there and hauled hay. At that time, you'd have the square hay bales that were, you know, roughly, you know, a little over 3 foot long and 18 inches wide, or whatever the dimensions of was, but they would weigh 80 to 100 pounds. That's what said that was our weight lifting and for football. But that was all the works to that. We put that in a barn. Nowadays, if anybody drives around the field, they'll see these big round bales of hay. You know, it all goes to that. But those square bales, when you baled them, you had to make sure you would get them and put them in the barn before it would rain, because if you didn't, if it rained on them, it would ruin the hay. And now with the big round hay bales, you know, it can be baled, and obviously, you know, those hay bales just sit outside and, you know, year round, you know. So that was a big change in the farming industry too. But
the early strippers, were they two-row?
Two-row, was that, yes.
And then they went from a stripper to nearly a picker. Some of them had pickers.
Yeah, then
the
they went.
The difference between a stripper and a picker?
Well, the stripper basically, it goes in and it when it picks the cotton, it pulls the cotton and the hull around it all goes into the bin. When the cotton pickers come in, they would pull the cotton out of the hull and just have the cotton going into the baskets. So
in the last, at least the last decade, another issue with farming is you have to move the equipment from farm to farm. The farmer has to have more acres in order to make a living, and the roads are somewhat crowded.
The roads are crowded, and one thing that has happened in the rural areas that a lot of people don't realize, when the roads have been rebuilt, a lot of times they just add to the road. They don't go down and start at the base what they were before. So every time they work on a road, you know, the road may be 6 inches higher than it was the year before. So when you're going down the road years ago with a tractor, you could, if you were going to meet somebody, you could pull off the road and let the car go by or whatever. You cannot do that now, because if you know, it's a straight drop, you might turn the tractor over, so you can't get off the road. And you also have this equipment that's real big, so it's kind of a playing chicken with the cars whenever you go down the road. Everybody has to have respect for each other to, you know, for you go down the road and get it accomplished. I know there's some people, if you get closer to Pflugerville, that the police department, they'll call the police department, and the police department will go back and escort them from one farm to another, so that, you know, so it can be done safely.
Also, in the rural area, it's become a destination place for the biking industry. Biking has become very popular in the last 10 or 15 years. And how does that impact the movement or traffic on the roads?
Well, it really impacts, like when you're moving farm equipment, but it also you know, really affects all the traffic flow. And I think that, you know, we've really just been fortunate, and as far as I know, in the Pflugerville area, that there hadn't been any deaths attributed to that. I know you see it several times a year in the papers that that happens, where some bicyclist that unfortunately was in an accident. You know, the one thing that I have, they have organized bike races, you know, which I guess that works pretty good, but some of the other, I guess, if you go to some of the other places around here, you go to Palmer Lane, you go to some of the other roads, you'll go Howard Lane. If you go to those roads, they have designated bike lanes, and you never see a bicycle there. So I really don't understand what some of these bicycle, that's why they do not use those areas where a safer environment would be provided for them, because I guess they get out on these country roads and they think it's nice to drive out and look at the countryside, but it does create a problem.
It's either kind. Let me talk back to, I want to say one thing about the farming back before the hay bales. They had thrashers. My dad and his brother had a thrasher for oats, bundles of oats, and the thrasher would get the grain out, but throw the other out and made a huge stack in the field for the cows to eat over the winter. But they would go to our neighbors. This was probably in the late 40s and early 50s, I guess. But you had to get the straw to the machine. So everybody would take their tractor and trailer, and you'd get three or four neighbors all helping each other, and everybody would, there was probably even horses back and then still doing that, I believe, to get the shocks of oats and bring it to the machine. So that was kind of an interesting time to do that and help your neighbor, and just it was like a big party in a way.
Well, families did a lot together. They also had a meat club.
Yes.
How did that work?
I know our grandmother, I don't think we did it at our house, but I know our grandmother, Fluger, they had a meat club, and I don't know if it was like once a week or, but they would order the meat and they would get it delivered. And
I think some of that back then, from what I understand it, because that was a little bit, you know, prior to, we did not do that when we were growing up, but I know that I think they would, one individual would butcher a steer, and then everybody would share that steer, and then the next week they kind of rotated on, you know, shared. It was good community. They had their neighbors, and everybody had good meat. They you know, they shared it, and I think that's the other thing. When he was talking about the one thing that I think is the background of what of Pflugerville, like you're talking about the thrashing. Well, everybody did to their neighbors. Everybody worked together, and not only on the farming, but when they, you know, if there was anything with the school or anything else, they got together and did that. And you know, when they worked hard back in those days, you know, it kind of can get, you know, when you go eat, what do you, you go eat breakfast, then your next meal, what is your next meal? You know, a lot of people, it's a lunch. And then the next meal, you know, is dinner, whatever. But you know, back in those days, they had breakfast, then they had lunch, then they had dinner, and then they had lunch, and then they had supper, because they worked hard enough where at 10 o'clock in the morning they would have sandwiches or whatever, and then they would have their you know, dinner at 12 noon, and they'd have lunch again like at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and then they would have supper, which we're talking about food. Will kind of reminds me of one of the things that we haven't talked about is the Lively Cafe in Pflugerville. That was an icon, and you know, people come from miles around to eat there. And that was, I can remember when I was in high school or in junior high there, you would go there, you'd have to wait outside sometimes to get in, and when you went in to eat, they had a plate lunch, and it was 50 cents for the small one and 75 cents for the large one. And that's what, like, a lot of times the way they did that, because you had some of the people, you know, that had, were business people in Pflugerville, that had a job behind a desk, would eat that small lunch, and the farmers that had come in that were working hard, they would eat the large lunch, you know. But you had those choices you know, but that was, but the Lively Cafe was known for miles around for their food and you know, another their desserts. One of the Miss Lively was very famous for was her coconut pies, you know, too. But I mean, there was it was really one of the, you know, a great restaurant in like a lot of other things in Pflugerville at that time.
Yeah, I think her hamburgers were great too. I think they were, I want to say a quarter, maybe 20 cents, but I think a quarter, just a hamburger. You'll get a great hamburger. And J.B. Marshall's groceries were right across the street from her, so if she ever needed anything for hamburger, you know, lettuce, tomato, onions, whatever, meat, she'd go over to Miss Marshall or call Miss Marshall and she'd bring it over and they were, you know, good to go.
Well, the other thing, and he's talking about that, but is you're talking about the meat. You know, there. The other thing was then you had, there was other people before, but when in our time, Pflugerville Meat Market was there, you could go there and you know, get your meat. But then he also, you know, like when I was in high school, one of the daily routine, you know, the weekly routines was you had football games on Friday night, and on Saturdays you went to Pflugerville Market to eat barbecue and hot sausage and that, and they made their own hot sausage. They made, you know, barbecue that, and like I said, they had, that's where, you know, you go in the store, tell him what you wanted, and he'd have a half a beef hanging there, and he'd go cut off the, you know, cut the meat straight off of, you know, the big half beef, you know, there.
Yeah. George Pfluger owned that.
Yeah.
The meat market.
That's right. He had hot guts, too.
Yes.
Yes.
Hold on 1 second. We got 15 minutes left. If you could I get you to take that ring off, because it's every time you're tapping, it's popping on your mic.
Oh, okay.
Sounds like somebody's got a hammer on their chair.
Okay.
Sorry about that.
No problem.
Make sure you put it back on when you get through.
All right.
Okay.
Good. There you go.
Sorry.
All right. I want to talk just briefly about the guinea toss during Deutschenfest. Who sponsored that?
First State Bank did.
And what was the, tell us about it.
Well, that was a big ordeal. For the guineas, when you had the guineas, John Pfluger was president of the bank, and we had an individual. His name was Fred Zwerneman. His relatives were from Dimebach, so that was a big event for those two and whoever would ride with him and want to have a good time. That they would leave and go down to some of his relatives and they would get the guineas, bring them back in a box, and you know on a Friday or whatever to get ready for the event on a Saturday. The event was held in downtown Pflugerville a few years, and when we had the guinea toss there, we'd go on top of the building where Dodge City Steakhouse is. Myself or somebody else would go up on the roof there, and you'd get a guinea, and you would throw it up in the air, and it would take off flying, and then everybody would chase that guinea, and whenever they catch it, whoever get it would bring it back, and I think that at that time we gave them either 10 or I think it was $10, it may have been $20 later that they would get for catching that guinea. And you know, that would take place several times, like, you know, a couple of them every hour on the hour or whatever. So that was one of the events that we had when when it was moved down to Pfluger Park. Then we had someone would climb the windmill that was down there, and they would throw, turn the guineas loose from on top of the windmill. But that was very exciting, you know, event, you know.
And the guineas could fly that high.
Yeah.
It was not
they could fly, and then they would run. And, I mean, it was not, the guinea could fly, and the guinea was also very, a fast runner. When you were out on the farms, people had chickens and turkeys and guineas, and the turkeys and chickens were pretty well kept in pens and stuff, but the guineas were allowed to run wild, so to speak, because they didn't have to worry about coyotes or other varmints getting them, because you know they could fly up in a tree, or they were quick enough that they didn't worry about varmints getting them.
I understand that the guinea thing happened earlier also in Pflugerville's history, maybe in the, I don't know, 30s, 40s, somewhere. They would release it from the First State Bank building up there, and they would fly all the way down to the gin or whatever, and the businesses in that group would put a little tag on their leg to give them a discount at their store or something. So it sounds like maybe there's a history before they started doing it at the fire department also, and they would usually catch them, and sometimes it sounded like even they maybe not catch them all, but like later in the week somebody would find it and they would, you know, come to the store and say. It was very, very evidently a popular thing to do.
There was a severe drought in the late 50s. Could you talk about that?
You want to drive? Well, one of the things that, as far as that drought, is our parents, one of the things that to try to meet family needs, my dad had 1,000 caged hens to try to help with the family income that they would do. And the thing I remember about the drought was, even though that chicken house was especially built with aluminum tin on the top to keep it cooler, that with the drought and the hot weather, that we had a lot of the chickens that weren't able to withstand the heat, and we lost quite a few of our chickens on a daily basis, that quite a few of them would die. And we also had one of the other things that was besides the chickens was that we had a shallow well, so we had to get Travis County, one of the services that they presided at that time, where they had a 2,000 gallon truck that delivered water to the rural areas. So we'd have to order water, you know, from there. So, I mean, that's the only way to get it, and you can only get it ever so often. So you had to be very conservative on your water and watch what you did with it, with the livestock. And that was one of the things, like trying to cool that squirting water on top of that chicken house to try to cool it down. You had to watch what you used because you didn't have that much water available. But that was what you can add.
I think some of those days, too, that when we lost quite a few of those chickens, it's like the temperature was like, 110, 105, 110. It wasn't like 100 or that. It really got hot. I know, 4 or 5 years ago, it was like that also. I think we set a record, maybe it was like 90 or a bunch of days where it was over 100 degrees. It got up to 115 or something there 4, 5, 6 years ago. But yeah, back then it was when it really, there were some days it got like I said, 110 degrees, and it was just hot and still, and it was just almost.
Technology is also changing that. When we have that the farmers pretty well, you know, the drought, they made very little crops. They pretty well didn't make it. Nowadays with technology, they've developed crops that can withstand more drought, less water, whatever, where, you know, you make a little bit of something, you know. But that's a significant.
If you get one good rain of 3 or 4 inches in at the right time, and you can still make a crop today where you couldn't back then.
You've also seen land around you change, particularly the airport from Bird's Nest to the Austin Executive Airport. You want to talk about that development?
It's real close to us, and I thought it would be a nuisance, I guess, with the noise and everything. But surprisingly, it's very quiet. The planes do not make that much noise as I thought they would. I mean, that's one thing, because I thought it would really be, because our property is right next to it. But anyway, that's one thing that surprised me, that it's not that not noisy, and it's kind of nice to watch them take off and and land. Just have to be careful. We have still cattle in the area, you know, so it's like you can't let cattle get on the runway, so we have to make sure our fences are good, that type of issue. And
you're a member of the Farm Bureau and actually serve on its board of directors. What do you see as farming in the next 5, 10, or 50 years in this area or around?
Well, one of the things in this area is, when I had said something earlier about Gatlinburg, well, you know, that was a farm. They put a subdivision there, Brook Hollow, you know, it's a farm, you know, every year, and it's every year now. You go out and there's you see corn growing there 1 year. The next year, there's houses there, you know. And of course, the people that have the land, it's, you know, they're getting good prices for the land. But, you know, nationwide, you wonder about that, you know, there's only so much land, and I mean, there's concerns about you know, the productivity and you know, have enough food for everybody and everything. But when you get back to the other, with the technology they have now, you know, today's they've made so many advancements on the productivity of the crops, and just like everybody else is involved with computers in their work, they have tractors now that they put GPS systems on. They go into a field and they basically, well, the farmer still rides in them and turns them around on the end, but there's no precise. So he was talking earlier about this row didn't match up with the other row. There's none of that. It's all precision by the computer. The computer goes back, and when the tractor turns around and it goes back, it's going to be a certain distance from the spot it was before, and it guides the tractor. It's going to stay on that line. That's like in a lot of your big farmers, they have that. Of course, a lot of this technology, that's why, you know, a lot of people don't realize. You go out and look at these farmers, and you think they're doing good and doing that. You go by and see a combine out harvesting those crops. That combine is probably cost over $400,000. And you go see stripping cotton, that stripper probably cost over $600,000. They have all this technology in them, just like your computer system. Well, that's, you know, world, you know, in the United States, there's just a lot of these big farmers up in Nebraska and all that. They have all this, you know, computerized stuff. There's people, farmers up there that they have two big farmers that have a couple of people that just work for them, and all they do is look at the computer data. When that combine harvests the grain, it goes and records exactly where it is, how much grain is being made per acre and everything, and that's recorded in the computer. Whenever they come back the next year to put out fertilizer, they have that information in there. They know exactly where they are, so that machine putting out the fertilizer would all automatically adjust to put out more fertilizer in the area where they had lower yields, and there's just a lot of, you know, technology you know, in there. But, you know, but that's one of the reasons when you start doing things like that, as I said earlier, you know, my father, when he farmed, you know, he farmed a couple of hundred acres, and I farm more than that just on a weekend, because you have the big equipment and technology and stuff where you can take care of that, where back then, you know, they had to work, you know, from sun up to sundown to farm the 200 acres, you know, that it was that much time involved in it.
I want to go back to the city of Pflugerville, because we only have a few minutes left. Some of the early leaders were Mr. I.B. Krenke and W.E. Pfluger and Tuff Knebel. They were actually the mayor and the council people for the first 10 or 12 years. Any recollections of those individuals?
I know I.B. was, he was also a Sunday school teacher. He taught us Sunday school for quite a few years. I remember that about him.
He was also he was the insurance man,
insurance,
I think, for Lutheran Mutual
Insurance.
W.E. Pfluger was the president of First State Bank of Pflugerville for many years. And Tuff Knebel, he had Knebel's Tavern. So those were all people that, Tuff and Mr. Pfluger, that had a pulse, so to speak, on the what was going on in the city. Because, you know, I guess if you go back and look at some of them, you think of Tuff Knebel, you probably hear more about what's going on in the city or what needs to be done in the city at the tavern when people get off of work and are relaxing and have time to think more about their daily lives, you know, that there was a lot of, you know, they learned a lot, you know, in
those
settings.
Solve all the issues there.
There was a time when, many years as I worked at the bank, I had one of the individuals I leased land from, and he would be at Knebel's Tavern on a daily basis, and I would walk into the bank and they'd say, well, we've done more business in here today than you did today. And if there was more money that changed hands at that table and changed at the bank, you know. But there was a lot to that they did talk about different issues and what needed to be done. If they had that in later years, they come up with some discussion with me there, they would, you know, contact a city councilman, or there may be a city councilman was sitting there with them. But they would get ideas of what, you know, what needs to be done in the city. So, and a lot of those people were prominent people in the city that were, you know, participating in those at the tavern there. So.
Well, All right. Well, is there anything else you want to add about living in Pflugerville that you've enjoyed?
Well, there's one thing I guess you'd say. You know, when I first started, I said when I graduated college, I didn't want to leave Pflugerville because I enjoyed Pflugerville. That's where all my friends are, and we did a lot of things. And I guess, you know, we've had a lot of growth. A lot of it is good. Sometimes I wish it wasn't growing as fast as it is. But I guess the one thing I think that over the years that you still had people involved that had the integrity and go back and look at the roots of Pflugerville and try to look at those roots and try to keep the Pflugerville, respect those roots and try to go back and keep those. And I think that's one thing we need to look at in the future. I guess there's always a saying that I've heard growing up, you know, people moved here, you know, because they visit here and they like what they saw. So when you get here, don't try to change it to the way things were where you left. You know, leave it like it was. You know, you left somewhere to come here because it was better, so don't try to change it to where you came from. You know, so I think that's one of the things, advice I would leave to some people. But
yeah. It's nice to have all the restaurants and shopping and everything. You don't have to go to Austin or wherever. You can go just a couple miles to just about any restaurant you want now or shopping. So that's a good thing. Like you said, the growth can be too much growth, I guess, too fast. It's maybe not a good thing. Yeah, probably farming in 10, 15 years out our way, there's probably not going to be any farms out there anymore. It's going to be all houses and subdivisions and so forth. So the farms are going to be, you know, farther and farther out, I guess. So
it's coming. You just need to plan for it and make, you know, try to make the best plans to, you know, have things done that would be good to preserve. You know, it's like downtown Pflugerville or something else, or when they, you know, something is being built. I think that, you know, the planning and zoning, they have certain places where when you build something here, it's going to have to meet certain standards, or you can't go up and put a tin building in the middle of downtown Pflugerville. It's going to have to be brick or whatever, so that you keep Pflugerville. I mean, when we grew up, the one thing is Pflugerville, we always figured that we might have been right, but, and I won't mention anything, but we always thought our little Pflugerville, when we grew up, that our town was a little bit better than some of our neighboring towns because of the people and Pflugerville was more progressive and like getting their waterworks going, and they finally put in some streets and some other things. But we've always been, you know, a step ahead of some of the of our surrounding communities, you know, and I think that's good, you know.
Thank you for your time. Thank you for your service. Thank you.